Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Hazards of Good Breeding by Jessica Shattuck, narrated by Suzanne Elise Freeman. Preface. The Dunlap House sits on the western slope of the third largest hill in Middlesex County, like a dark spot between the green fields of the Ponkatosset Golf Course and the Merritt School for the Blind. It is an austere place, built in 1820, with black shutters, a peaked carpenter's roof, and a slight list to its mahogany-stained clapboards, as if a powerful magnet under the old root cellar is gradually pulling the whole structure back into the earth. There has been a house on this spot since 1747, when the first John Forsyth Dunlap turned in his barrister's wig, bought 3 chickens and 2 pigs, and moved west from Boston to farm the land. According to the Old Houses of Concord pamphlet put out by the local chapter of the DAR, the house he built was burned to the ground by his daughter Abigail in protest of his domineering ways. According to the current John Forsyth, known as Jack Dunlap, this is hogwash. He has conducted his own research on the matter and determined that it was the Ponkatosset Indians who set fire to the property in one of their fierce, but little discussed, raids. And while in most things Jack is a private and uncommunicative man, he likes to tell this story. This is in part to set the record straight. He cannot let the truth fall victim to a bunch of gossiping DAR members, and in part because he loves the great American drama of property ownership, which is more vivid in his version of the story. For the last 254 years, minus a brief interlude Jack thinks of as the occupation, the house has remained in Dunlap Whiteside family hands. Jack himself bought the house back from the interloping owners, a Swiss couple named the Niederbergers, whom he remembers as weak-chinned, soulless-looking people who had the gall to install a jacuzzi in the 200-year-old butter churn room, carve skylights into the kitchen, and paint the ancient clapboards a cheerful butter yellow. Mr. Niederberger had made millions selling some marvel of Swiss engineering, which he described at length to Jack during their one conversation. But Jack was thinking of the ancient Franklin stone the man had had melted into ball bearings and heard nothing but white noise. Jack's ex-wife, Faith, remembers the couple as sweet and sorrowfully childless, and she liked the house the way it looked under their care. She had to stand aside, though, and watch as Jack restored its original gloomy colors and awkward proportions, as he ripped up the comfortable wall-to-wall carpeting and tore out the offending jacuzzi. The skylights in the breakfast room were her one triumph. Jack couldn't take them out without putting in a whole new roof. On sunny winter days, she could find refuge on the sofa beneath them, with her favorite plaid throw blanket and a copy of People. But even there, in her woolly pool of sunlight, the presence of all the dark rooms beyond the doorway made itself felt. She has never, even for a moment, missed one thing about the place, which has, in retrospect, come to seem like the stern and joyless embodiment of her marriage. When Jack and Faith's daughter Caroline is at home, she likes to count new cracks in the ceilings, moth holes in the curtains, and dead flies in the window sashes. It has come to seem funny to her, all this opulent decrepitude and self-consciously maintained lack of creature comfort. But at the same time, it is the house she grew up in, which makes it all she really knows. Over the holidays, when she is back from school, she burns candles in her bedroom and listens to weepy female vocalists and Led Zeppelin. This seems to clear the way for the present, which otherwise enters 23 Memorial Road, stillborn. For Eliot Dunlap, the youngest of Jack and Faith's children, the house is not just his home, but his world. A disparate collection of cities and states, geographies and regions, each with its own climate, history, and culture. The dining room, for instance, is a repressive totalitarian state, the pink and white guest room, an inviting but neglected warm weather island. His favorite places are outside the house, the dappled clearing in the middle of the rhododendron bushes, and the small wood of red pines, golden beeches, and startling white birch trees that separates the Dunlaps field from the Ponkatosset golf course. Eliot calls this Sarajevo. It is a name he has heard somewhere before, which seems as lovely and mysterious as this place is. At dusk, he likes to collect lost golf balls buried here among the pine needles, elephant ear ferns, roots, and fallen branches. In the last reflective light of the evening, these glimmer a soft and otherworldly purple. And from above, the wood takes on the look of a sieve, a universe full of tiny, bright, unpatchable holes. 1. Caroline Dunlap has always been surrounded by crazy men. First of all, there is her father, who wakes at 5 every morning to build Revolutionary War dioramas and sleeps with his grandfather's ancient 9-gauge pistol under his pillow. Then there are her identical twin older brothers, who are famous throughout the New England Independent School League for having swung, flying Walenda style, from the St. Stephen's Chapel bell tower into the headmaster's bathroom on a string of knotted dress shirts. There is also Wheelie Barrett, the retired NHL player who mows the Dunlap's lawn and believes the 747s flying en route to Logan drop gelatinous sewage byproducts over the roses and boxwood bushes behind the house. Then there are the hundreds of sales clerks, bus passengers, mail flight attendants, paper delivery boys, bank tellers, and lost pedestrians who have a much higher incidence of insanity in Caroline's life than in anyone else's she knows. Just yesterday, a man sitting on a park bench beside her got up and tried to urinate on a pigeon. Last on the list, there is Rock Coughlin, who is, at this moment, sitting cross-legged on the floor at the foot of Caroline's childhood bed. Caroline blinks to make sure she is awake and pulls herself up onto one elbow, knocking her shoulder against the headboard. "Good morning," Rock grins before she is even fully upright. "Rock!" Caroline looks at the ancient ET alarm clock on the bedside table. 7:47, its eyes blink at her. "What are you doing here?"
"Welcoming you back."
Rock says this as if she has asked him what color his hair is or if he is breathing.
"While I was sleeping?"
Caroline stares at him.
"You looked so peaceful. I didn't want to wake you."
"Hmm," Caroline says, reaching for the pack of cigarettes beside her bed.
"That's creepy."
"You did the right thing, you know. Coming back here, you would have hated San Francisco. The whole city is like a fucking telecommunications ad, and everyone is into mountain biking and fleece vests and..."
Caroline lights her cigarette and takes a drag. She sweeps her eyes around the room. From floor to ceiling, it is populated by the hopeful, temporary objects of her childhood. James Dean posters, trophies, an empty glass hamster cage, her ancient dilapidated dollhouse. In the middle of this, her duffel bags and crates of CDs, toiletries, and poster rolls look out of place, like garbage washed up on some innocent New England beach. Within the few minutes it has taken her to fully absorb this, Rock has launched into a story about a group of monks he met in Harvard Square, an orange t-shirt he was wearing, and the possibility that it, or they, or some combination of circumstances, represents his calling. Caroline is not really listening, though. She has to figure out how to reclaim her mourning from him. Rock has been known to spend hours in the company of those who don't want his.
At Quilton, the boarding school he and Caroline both went to, he was famous for following Kirsten Hedren to a bikini wax during their breakup. Caroline already has to take her little brother Eliot to his school play this morning, which will have its challenges without Rock trailing after her with some dilettantish dilemma about his spiritual future. Her mother is making her first trip back to Concord since she left it last year to be at the play for one thing, which is sure to be traumatic. Faith Dunlap nearly collapses upon contact with her dry cleaner, not to mention the bevy of ex-golf partners and country club pals she is sure to run into at the Barton Country Day School.
I mean, they don't ask everyone to come live with them, Rock is saying. What if they just saw something, like a halo over my head? Some sign invisible to most people?
I don't think Buddhists believe in halos, Caroline says. Rock ignores her. He has begun running his hand along her bookshelf, rocking every third book forward. For the first time, it occurs to her he might be slightly serious. You're too old to become a monk anyway, Rocky. Caroline sighs. Those guys practically start training in utero.
That's the whole point, though. They wanted me to come because there was a link between us, something that would make me able to learn their prayers or meditations or whatever faster than, you know, you or your brothers or any other normal American.
Oh, right, of course, Caroline says, blowing a cloud of smoke out the open window. At the moment, Rock actually looks almost childish. He is 24 years old, but with his shaggy brown hair flattened and explosive-looking on one side. His pillow? Or has he fallen asleep on the beach again? Skinny legs and bleach-stained green shirt, he could easily still be in high school. He has lost weight over the last year, mulching gardens and breeding asparagus or whatever it is he was doing at the organic farm he worked at. Caroline herself looks exactly the same, though. She glances at the face reflected in the pink Miss Piggy mirror hanging over Rock's head. She has just graduated from college, broken up with her boyfriend of 2 years, and, on account of this, thrown any semblance of plans for her immediate future out the window. She would like, at least, to look tired. But the face that stares back out at her is remarkably smooth and calm, hardly different than it was a year ago, or, for that matter, 10 years ago when she was 12. Straight blonde hair cut to her shoulders, gray eyes, silvery eyebrows, and sharp, straight features that manage, without fail, to give the impression of competence and reserve.
I mean, what if I just passed up the one thing I was really meant to do in my life? The one really meaningful thing? Rock continues. I mean, it's not like I'm stemming the tide here. Like there's even any tide to be stemmed here.
His book rocking has become feverish.
You know what I mean?
Caroline swings her legs over the side of the bed. I do, actually. She stubs the cigarette out in the water glass beside the alarm clock. I don't know if hanging out in a robe and decoding parchment papers or whatever all day is the answer, but she stands up and looks down at him. Maybe. Rock stops harassing the books, leaving his right index finger on her high school copy of Moby Dick.
Hmm.
He chews on his bottom lip, flummoxed by her concession.
I guess it might drive me crazy.
Outside on the lawn, Caroline can see Wheelie rounding the edge of the garage on his new Gatorade orange tractor mower. He has a pink linen napkin tied over his head, protecting against the sewage. It might just do that, Caroline says, standing up. Rocky? She pushes a hand through her hair. I really have to get dressed now. Caroline's younger brother, Eliot, the dregs of his parents' conjugal activity, has made it to age 10 with a certain degree of grace, virtually unheard of in men of the Dunlap family. He is a slender boy, small for his age, with snowy blonde hair and a high cheekboned, almost Slavic-looking face. There is something secretive, but not dishonest, about his demeanor that comes, maybe, because in his lifetime he has already had so much exposure to silence. He has a birthmark shaped like a Christmas tree on his left shoulder, and wide, speckled gray-blue eyes, which are, not without reason, exceptionally wary. This morning, he is sitting in the kitchen, fully costumed, mouthing the lines he has to recite in his school play, and cutting a banana into his bowl of cornflakes. He has been interrupted once by a shaggy apparition that turned out to be Rock Coughlin rapping on the front door, but since then he has sat in meditative silence. Occasionally there is a rattling, thumping sound as Brutus, one of his father's beloved blue heelers, throws himself against the wire gate pulled shut between the mudroom and the kitchen. Eliot checks his watch. In 20 minutes, Caroline is supposed to drive him to school, but he has not heard the shower turn on upstairs yet. The play is his drama teacher's musical adaptation of Paul Revere's Ride, the Longfellow poem, which is one of Eliot's favorites. He loves the acute sense of urgency and fate embedded in the story. He loves the lilt of "One if by land, two if by sea, and I on the opposite shore shall be," and the dark, garbled images of phantom ships and huge black hulks, the reflections and silence and eager ears that populate the second verse, which makes him think of fairies. Most of all, he likes the phrase, "a shape in the moonlight, a bulk in the dark," as if the weight of the man's deed has transformed him into some vague and formidable agent of the future, the way darkness transforms a laundry pile into a body, or a hunchback with an evil eye. The play is not without its challenges, though. The essential role of a horse, not allowed in the theater, the school requirement that drama productions include dance, which is hardly organic to the story, and the varied ages and skills of the actors, from Lucy Poole, who is not yet fully toilet trained, to Eliot himself, who can recite the whole poem by heart. Eliot has been awake since 6 this morning with a gnawing premonition of disaster. Eliot shifts in his seat and his knickers make a synthetic peeling sound on the stool. His costume is something of a sore spot. The knickers are all right, a bright, shiny royal blue, but the tunic is too fussy. It was originally sewn for his drama teacher's son, who was Aladdin for Halloween. Eliot and his teacher have made a pact to keep this quiet. Unlike most of the other Barton Country Day mothers, Elliot's mother no longer lives in the greater Boston area and would not have the wherewithal to sew her son a costume even if she did. For his head, Eliot and his drama teacher have constructed a tri-cornered hat from triangles of thick brown felt glued and stapled together in a haphazard heap, which bears a surprising resemblance to a stack of pancakes. Eliot keeps this at school, in a carefully tented paper bag at the bottom of his cubby.
"One if by land, two if by sea," Eliot says bravely into the empty kitchen, but the image of himself forming a sweaty-handed bridge with Josh Hopkins intrudes on the rhythm of the language and erases the next verse from his head. It will be his mother's first trip back to Concord in 1 year. "Will Penny Harley's mother be there? Will Anne Kittredge? And should I wear a pants or a skirt, or is it a kind of blue jeans thing?" she wanted to know on the phone last night. Eliot did his best to provide the answers. The conversation left him with a tight,
hard feeling in his stomach, which makes his digesting cornflakes feel like bird food. When Eliot is done with his cereal, he drops lightly to the floor and pads across the linoleum to the sink, careful not to knock off the cardboard buckles he has taped to his bedroom slippers. He rinses his bowl, places it in the dish rack, and then stands still for a moment, spoon poised in midair, staring out the window. There is a cardinal perched on a branch of the apple tree, not more than 5 feet from the house. His babysitter, Rosita, always said if you can stare at a bird and count to 20 before it flies away, it will bring you a wish. Eliot counts slowly, spelling Mississippi between every number. He knows what he will wish for, Rosita's return. He misses the way she hums when she washes dishes and nods her head when she listens, the way her lips form the words when she is reading recipes or the directions on the back of cleaning supplies. There is something reassuring about the presence of her solid brown body in the house, about the sharp sting of Spanish she speaks into the phone. She has been gone for almost 6 months now.
Hey, if it isn't Rex Harrison.
Rock Coughlin's voice shoots through the doorway, frightening the bird away. Eliot has just gotten to 19. El, what are you doing? Caroline says from behind him. She has been home for less than a day, and already she has taken the bossy, worried tone of someone on the lookout for disaster. Aren't you supposed to get dressed at school? Eliot puts the spoon in the dish rack and turns around without answering.
What's the part, Aladdin?
Rock asks.
No,
Eliot stiffens. You look great, Caroline adds hastily. Eliot lifts his backpack off the counter and looks straight at her.
Can we go?
He asks.
I'll stay here and wait for you,
Rock announces from the table, where he is noisily rifling through the newspaper. Caroline and Eliot both turn to stare at him, gape-mouthed. The idea of him here in the house when they are gone, and the only sound is the hum of the refrigerator and the tinkle of the wind chime, makes Eliot start sweating. It'll be a while, Caroline says, frowning. I have errands to do when it's over.
No problem. Maybe I'll play a little frizz with DD.
DD? Caroline raises her eyebrows.
Daddy Dunlap,
Rock says, grinning. Alarm shoots through Eliot.
He doesn't like frisbee, he says automatically.
Oh, sure he does. I'll show him the old over-easy.
Whatever that is. Caroline glares at the top of his head. Anyway, I don't think... She cuts herself off, and a strange, stricken look comes over her face. Oh, Elle, you don't think... Do you think he'll come to your play this morning?
No,
Eliot says firmly. He has had to assure his mother of this fact at least once every phone call for the last 6 weeks.
He has a meeting.
Okay, Caroline says uncertainly. The possibility of their mother and father in the same room seems to dull her worry about Rock, who is still sitting, now with the antique chair tipped up on its back legs, at their kitchen table. Eliot does not feel similarly liberated. Caroline follows his gaze to Rock and shrugs, lifting her hands in a gesture of helplessness. Don't burn the house down, she says to Rock, jingling her car keys.
Just the garage, Rock says.
Hey, break a leg,
he calls after Eliot, in what seems like a less than reassuring send-off. Left alone in the house, Rock continues shuffling through the paper until it hits him that he is in the house alone. Caroline's house alone. Jack Dunlap's house alone. It is an exciting thought. He could jerk off right here, at their kitchen table. But the idea is vulgar, unsensual. Rock is after something finer. He closes the paper and pushes his chair back, almost overturning it. There is a sudden wild barking from the mudroom from one of the Dunlap devils, Rock's personal nickname for the blue-black beasts Jack Dunlap breeds and raises.
"Hey,"
he says, standing up and walking toward the refrigerator. The dog stops barking and stands very still.
"Where's your partner?"
Then he realizes the dog is not actually silent. There is an ugly, almost inaudible growl coming from its chest. Rock opens the refrigerator and closes it quickly. The dog is making him nervous. The kitchen is uninteresting anyway. The secrets it holds, dietary preferences, cleanliness, brand affiliation, are chaste, feminine, busybody material. Rock is after deeper, more psychological insight. Rock has known the Dunlap since he was a boy, and his mother introduced Faith Dunlap to the writings of Deepak Chopra. This has not ceased to amuse Rock since his mother proudly recounted it last Thanksgiving. It proves his theory that reading spiritual self-help books is a harbinger of disaster. Rock has been by the Dunlap's house plenty of times since the divorce. To drive Caroline home from the likes of Adam Lowell's Yankee swap party or B.B. Mender's 21st birthday. But it has been a long time since he has been inside it. He heads through the door to the dining room, which is long and dark and boring, full of framed oil paintings and a grim, precise rubbing of some English ancestor's tombstone. He has a vague memory of dinner here, long ago, when he was still playing peewee hockey with the Dunlap boys. There was something uncomfortable about it. A new pair of shoes, a scratchy shirt collar, maybe a silent pinch fight with Jack Jr. under the table. The library, which he pokes his head into, hoping for some immense, imposing desk to route through, is dark, spare, and unoriginal, down to the black iron Remington horse and rider on the mantel. No desk. Rock sprints up the stairs, enjoying the screech of the wood under his feet. The house epitomizes what he loves about this part of Massachusetts, the austerity of design, the carefully maintained modesty of its appointments, and the cultivation of a somber moral framework through household furniture. Where else in America would a man who just spent $2.2 million on an empty plot of land outside Sun Valley have a grubby, moth-eaten hall runner with matching, similarly decrepit drapes depicting tiny scenes of the Boston Tea Party? There is something so perfectly dysfunctional about it, but at the same time so bravely and sincerely hopeful. After all, isn't all this self-denial predicated on the idea that there is some sort of hereafter? At the top of the stairs and to the right is Caroline's room, the only room up here Rock has ever actually been into. He could read her journal, run his hands through her underwear drawer. But this is something anyone would do, and he has already been there once this morning. He continues down the hall and opens a door at the left. A battered wooden bunk bed and National Geographic posters of lion cubs, a panda, and a pregnant iguana. Eliot's room. In the middle, on the carpet, is a giant papier-mâché work in progress. A 4x4-foot landscape with big, ugly mounds of unpainted newspaper and clumps of dandruffy-looking trees. What the hell would compel the kid to make something like this? But this doesn't really interest Rock, except in so much as it reminds him he could get high. He gropes around in his pocket for the half-smoked joint he thinks he remembers. Yes, there it is, and pushes the screen open. Then he lights up, sits on the windowsill, and discreetly hangs the joint out the window, stooping to exhale into the fresh summer air. Storybook air. It actually smells sweet, of strawberries and cut grass. There are cicadas revving up in the trees like the disparate parts of some giant engine. Back out in the hall, Rock is drawn to the door at the end. Mr. Dunlap's room. Rock knows instinctively what it must be. He can feel his heart cluck and ruffle at the threshold. Inside, it is quite dark. Only one shade to the left of an enormous unmade bed has been partially pulled up. Rock hits the overhead light and floods the room with an ugly greenish-yellow fluorescence. There are newspapers, magazines, and white 8x12 institutional reports scattered on an ottoman and the carpet around it. On the right, two framed pictures draped with t-shirts. Rock pads across the carpet to peer at what is beneath these. A photo of Jack and his wife taken at their wedding, and a more recent, painfully posed family portrait. If he hates them so much, why hasn't he just removed them? Rock kicks his shoes off and scuffles his bare feet over the dark green carpet, feeling it chafe at the delicate, almost sticky skin of his arches. He never walks around without shoes. He worries about worms and tetanus, and that his feet are too thin for a man's, or that they are too pale, too hairy. He picks up the magazine lying face down on the bed, The Economist, open to an article about fear as an important motivator among canning industry workers. Rock stretches out on the burgundy sheets, flannel, slightly greasy feeling. They have a comfortable, bready smell that suggests they haven't been washed for weeks. Rock stares up at the ceiling and imagines he is Jack Dunlap, founder of A Marathon, Inc., terrorizer of the Ponkatosset Club Events Committee and Concord Junior League, father of the most beautiful girl he, Rock Coughlin, knows. 2. Faith Dunlap has never been good at packing. Looking ahead, planning strategically, incorporating variables, a hurricane, a rash, an unexpected party, has never been her forte. Once, when she was 10, she went to St. Bart's for 2 weeks with nothing but corduroys, wool sweaters, plaid skirts, and thick white tights. Her parents had never said it was a warm place, that it was different from Boston, New Hampshire, or the Cape, never mentioned palm trees or beaches or gecko lizards or anything else a 10-year-old would be interested in. That is the kind of parents they were. If they had been different, if they had held her hand on her first airplane trip, or remembered her birthdays, or let her sleep with a nightlight, things might have turned out differently. She might still be married and a good mother, someone capable of identifying and filling her own week's worth of needs, and packing in a jiffy. This is what she has determined from therapy. It is the simplest answer to the question of how she got to where she is now. This morning, sitting on the scratchy blue and gray polyester seat cushion of the 7:30 Delta shuttle she is taking up to Boston, from her new home in New York City, Faith is exhausted. She was up until nearly 1 a.m. packing, sorting through sweaters and blouses, creams and lotions, allergy medications and anti-anxiety pills. At midnight, she was still choosing her reading material, the last 5 issues of House Beautiful, or the novel Caroline sent her for her last birthday. Something thick but suspiciously light-looking. Does her daughter think she isn't capable of real literature? She packed and unpacked a first aid kit 3 times and replaced her 3rd pair of sandals with a pair of 12-year-old, never-used golf shoes. After her son's play, she is going to her old friend Lucy's summer home. And Lucy is so sporty. Faith will surely be roped into stressful rounds of tennis, badminton, golf, and croquet. Staring out the scratched double glass windows of the airplane, Faith can feel her blood pressure rising. From above, Boston looks just like any other city, an uneven grid of rectangles broken up by more rectangles, looped together by a few sinewy ribbons of road. Last week, Faith had a computer installed in her apartment so she could email with her children, a possibility that seems incredible to her still. The technician pulled out a flat metal panel covered with tiny squares and rectangles, called, what was it? It had such a sad, human-sounding name. The motherboard, that was it. It housed all the information the computer would ever need to carry out its operations, he explained. The mechanical equivalent of DNA. From here, the city looks remarkably like this thing. The shiny channels of highways, the smooth square tops of buildings. It seems almost mystical, this repetition of structure, as if both are reflections of the same archetypal image of order. When the plane touches down, Boston looks brighter and sunnier than Faith expected. It looks hot, in fact, the way the leaves on the trees sag and the grass is that deep, almost blurry shade of green. The captain makes an elaborate announcement about what gate they will be pulling into, in the same falsely enthusiastic, sidewalk salesman voice he has used throughout the flight, to fill passengers in on everything from cruising altitude to obscure geographical features of the Connecticut coastline.
88 degrees and rising,
he confirms Faith's suspicions. She is certainly wearing all the wrong things. The pink and white striped blouse she has on is long-sleeved, and her linen pants are lined. She will sweat through Elliot's performance, through her first visit back to Concord since she left it. The thought sends a shimmery burst of adrenaline from her gut to her heart. She is just going to a play, she tells herself. Just a morning, and then lunch with her children, and then she will be off. At least the twins, who have come to intimidate her with their baseball caps and loud voices and aggressive, uncommunicative way of speaking, are off in Colorado. And most importantly, Jack won't be there. She is lucky, really, to have this opportunity to see the place without him. It could be so much worse. The fact remains, though, that Faith dreads this morning at the play. All the hugs of sympathetic neighbors, curious glances of familiar strangers, and nosy, condescending, how are yous, and so good to see you back here's, of all the Barton Country Day mothers she has not seen since what Dr. Marcus suggests she think of as her time out, a term he accompanies with a referee-like gesture. Faith is a small, slim woman, only 5'5". Her limbs and fingers are long and nervous. When she sits down and crosses her legs, it is almost impossible to stop the anxious back-and-forth movement of her size 6 foot. She is pretty, also. Her features are delicate, indistinct, and give the impression of being somehow watery, as if, faced with something really shocking or gruesome, they would melt. This is misleading, though. In fact, Faith has been privy to more shocking, gruesome things than many women of her class and age group. When she was 19, for example, her older brother was decapitated in an auto accident, with Faith seated right beside him. There was an elm tree, a Bloody Mary in his hand, a tremendous sound of smashing machinery. She emerged from the overturned car with 2 cuts above her right eyebrow and a sprained wrist. Faith manages to get her own bag out of the overhead compartment, rustles it down the aisle and into the cool, antiseptic-smelling airport. Then she joins the masses of official, business-suited people streaming down the long gray hall to the taxi line out front. She feels like an imposter, someone who shouldn't be allowed to take such a professional, early morning plane.
"Where are you going?"
the driver asks when Faith is finally settled in the dark cavern of a yellow cab. "To BCD," she says, "in Belmont."
"BCD," he repeats.
Faith is not sure if it is a question or an affirmation. He is very thin, and his skin is so black it is almost bluish. His voice is surprisingly high and sorrowful sounding. "Barton Country Day School. Do you know where that is?" He shakes his head.
"Oh dear, I don't know if I remember what street it's on. It's sort of modern looking. I hope, I have it written down somewhere. Maybe you can just get started in that direction and I'll try to find. I can always ask directions in Belmont."
She lets her voice trail off. The driver does not answer, but pulls out into the traffic of the terminal. So typical of her to have forgotten the address. She roots around in her purse for her address book, which she can't find, but then it comes to her. "Bethune Street," she says. Up front, the driver nods without turning. Outside, the familiar, raggedy pink brick of Chelsea springs into view along the water, and in the distance, the Bunker Hill Monument, which has always struck Faith as mean-looking, full of shabby puritanical delusions of grandeur. It is strongly air-conditioned in the back seat of the taxi. Faith leans her head against the slippery black vinyl. There is an almost overpowering smell of berries. Sweet, artificial, but not at all unpleasant. It strikes her as effeminate, which gives her a surge of compassion for the driver, who seems vulnerable, someone so new to this country he has not yet absorbed its most basic gender prohibitions, someone who is probably made fun of behind his back.
"I can't believe I forgot the name of that street," Faith says aloud, in an excess of warm feeling toward him. "My children all went there. My husband, actually my ex-husband. It's just, I guess you don't really think about it. When you go there every day, drop off, pick up, you just think school, not Bethune Street."
The driver looks at her in the rearview mirror without smiling or nodding, and Faith immediately regrets her words. He has a gaunt face and bloodshot eyes, as if he has been driving all night. He is probably from one of those awful, war-torn countries whose names Faith always confuses. His wife and children are probably halfway across the planet, in some shanty with no toilet. Or worse, they are probably dead. And now Faith has reminded him of them with this frivolous talk about school, as if he had the opportunity to drop them off, pick them up. Her words ring inanely in her ears. His children probably never had the opportunity to learn to read. The driver turns the radio on and settles on a classical station, and the soft notes of a cello stream out of the speakers. Not the rock and roll or easy listening or daytime talk show Faith expected. Maybe he is from somewhere gentler than she had imagined, somewhere subtler and more full of longing than fear. Or maybe, is it possible to be somewhere both grim and full of longing? Faith does not know much about classical music, but she recognizes this piece, the low warble of cello strings and undulating motion that makes her think of someone running across a wide-open expanse of rolling hills in late afternoon sunshine. "Do you know what this is?" she asks, leaning forward. The driver looks at her in the rearview mirror.
"Music," he says.
"Ah." Faith nods and sits back. She rests her head against the smooth vinyl again and lets the sound take them both somewhere kinder and softer than here. Over the last few months, Jack Dunlap has become one of those people who do strange things in their sleep. He wakes up pounding the door to his closet, or sitting upright in his armchair, or slipping the key to the basement door into his left tennis sneaker. It gives him a feeling of shame and incompetence. What kind of man has he become that he doesn't collapse into the immobilizing embrace of a deep slumber? This morning, Jack has a crick in his neck from having spent the night with his head propped against the bedside table. He is beginning the day early, because he has two missions to accomplish before he goes to Elliot's performance. He has to swing by Colby Kesson, the poorly managed publishing business his company, a marathon, is in the process of buying out, and bring his dog Caesar to the breeders. He has cleared the rest of his appointments before lunch. It is unfair, after all, that just because she divorced him, his ex-wife should be the only one to see their son in his end-of-the-school-year performance. When they arrive at the breeders, Caesar waits obediently for Jack to let him out, watching with bright, almost cat-like eyes as a squirrel races up the trunk of a maple over Jack's shoulder. He is a good hunter for a blue heeler. He has caught two rabbits and a crow in the last 3 months, a feat Brutus, the smaller and more timid of Jack's two dogs, could never have accomplished. Jack loves his dogs, who are both descended from the first blue heeler in America, who belonged to Jack's grandfather. Part shepherd, part border collie, part dingo, there is a real animalness about them that is missing from so many breeds. Jack admires their firmness of intent and purpose. He trained them himself, and they are good dogs, obedient, watchful, and well-behaved. He can feed them from the same dish, one at a time, and they won't squabble as they did when they were puppies. Instead, they will sit back, licking their chops, waiting their turns with patience. With Caesar trotting at his heels, Jack crosses the Ridgeway's lawn to the side door of the house, which opens into a small concrete-floored room, off which Jim Ridgeway has several kennels. Jim is the biggest Australian cattle dog breeder in New England, and he loves Jack's dogs, whose height and speed and intelligence make their genes an excellent supply for local bloodlines. Jack lets Jim use them free of charge. The favor works both ways. Caesar especially is better behaved when he is mated. "Neuter them, for Christ's sake," Jack's daughter Caroline says. "Why do they need to be such stallions?" But Jack has no intention of acting on this suggestion. Jim comes to the door promptly at Jack's knock and takes the leash, pats Caesar on the shoulder. "He limping?" he asks, watching the dog nose along the baseboards of the room. Jack is impressed. The limp is almost gone. He himself can barely see it. "Stepped on a thorn," he says. Jim pulls his mouth down at the edges. He is a man of few words, which Jack admires. He does not engage in the smarmy innuendos and elbows in the ribs that Jack has found such deals often inspire. Nor does he make small talk about the weather, the price of science diet, or the prevalence of hip dysplasia among retrievers. He never offers Jack an obligatory cup of coffee. This morning, the whole exchange is complete in less than 4 minutes. From the Ridgeways, Jack makes his way to Colby Kesson. Colby Kesson is a company with the kind of new-age, self-actualization bent that makes it exactly the sort of business Jack resents including in the Amerathon umbrella. It sells educational kits online to disgruntled pharmacy clerks looking to become telephone switchboard operators, overweight secretaries with a yen to practice aromatherapy, Burger King fry boys who've always wanted to be shoe salesmen, and any number of other individuals with lateral movement career ambitions, which the kits will take no nearer to fulfillment than they already are. There was a time when Jack dreamed that a marathon would be the Tiffany's of American history textbook publishers, that it would build on the dignified reputation of the fusty 100-year-old textbook publisher he bought 20 years ago as the foundation for his business, and become bigger, better, and more widely known. But the demand for top-notch, finely printed, traditional textbooks at the price such books come at was, he found, remarkably low, limited to a few expensive boys' schools in the Northeast. So a marathon expanded. Jack bought out its lower-priced, lower-quality competitors, whose books featured chapters like The Female Minuteman and The American Holocaust, Lost Tribes of the Eastern Seaboard, which make Jack's skin crawl. He bought out humdrum newsletter publishers and esoteric local interest magazines, and eventually altogether non-publishing-related companies, like a chain of men's formal wear rentals called The Tasteful Tucks, and a motorboat detailing business on Cape Cod, all teetering on the edge of bankruptcy. And he has turned the businesses around, made them profitable parts of the Marathon umbrella. It would be downright un-American to turn his nose up at a business-building opportunity just because it didn't fit his concept. He is running a company, not a showroom, after all. But still, there are times when he hates the fact that he has created a well-run, well-oiled conglomerate that produces nothing but garbage. This was not the dream he began with. Today is Colby Kesson's monthly Choices Celebration, or simply Choices, as its organizers affectionately refer to it. Choices is a one-day seminar/retreat attended by any and all proud purchasers of Colby Kesson kits who wish to make a pilgrimage to Needham, Massachusetts, for some inspirational speaking and heartwarming sharing with their fellow consumers. It is one of the company's many fraudulent, life-affirming, profit-cramping extras. It will be the first thing Jack cuts when a marathon takes the helm. Unless, of course, he spots some hidden upside or untapped revenue-building opportunity today, which seems unlikely, based on the number of cars, less than 40, in the parking lot. Jack has timed his arrival so that he will be able to slip into the auditorium without having to identify himself and put up with the ridiculous, nervous kowtowing that accompanies his introduction under circumstances like these. He makes his way up to the balcony of the high school auditorium the event is held in and stands for a moment, letting his eyes adjust to the darkness. Colby Kesson has made some attempt to introduce cheer to this suffocatingly inoffensive cavern. A few insubstantial bouquets of purple balloons teeter in the corners, and a gold banner emblazoned with "Choose Your Future" hangs across the central aisle. But rather than fight off the relentless blandness of the space, they seem to feed it, like fresh drops of blood caught in the gaping, all-consuming gullet of mediocrity. Jack settles into one of the rear seats by the door and pulls out his notepad. Frank Barucci, the moist-eyed, frizzy-haired, ex-football captain, reformed cocaine addict type, leading the event, has opened the mic to the poor, floundering choosers, as Frank reverentially refers to his constituents. They are choosing happiness, choosing change, he has explained to Jack on the phone. In droves, they are getting up to make quavering comments about family and meaning and opportunity in the canned language of daytime talk shows. It drives Jack crazy, these people scraping up the rarest marrow of their lives and lofting it for approval or support or whatever it is they are looking for, as if such ephemeral slips of feeling can be hung out to weather the elements like flags. He hates the way Frank and his two assistants urge them on to these exhibitions. When did talking ever bring anyone anything but grief? He hates the Native American poetry the Colby Kessenites co-opt to lend their agenda spiritual clout. He hates the soothing tones they take care to speak in, the loose, cottony garments they wear. And he hates the people who are dumb enough to sign on to this program, who haven't the smarts or the mettle to take life by the horns. These, Jack thinks, are the new Americans, the ones who skew the national averages toward ignorance, selfishness, and obesity. Within 5 minutes of their fraudulent outpourings, Frank Barucci has actually worked up a good tablespoon of tears. Meanwhile, Jack has worked up Frank's severance package. 6 months' pay, a strong recommendation, a goodbye page on the company's website. Colby Kessen has remarkable potential once costly indulgences like choices can be taken out. Jack has a hungry 26-year-old Harvard Business School graduate who is set to turn the place around for 10% of the equity and 3 weeks' vacation time. At the podium, a man in a purple polo shirt is now describing how hard it was to learn bartending with a broken arm.
"Broke in two places."
Jack puts his notebook away. He has seen enough. By the time he has reached the door, a redhead with a pouchy face and battery-operated earrings has commandeered the mic to thank her husband for helping her discover her passion for dog grooming. Jack has to pause, one hand on the door handle, and scan the audience for the dickless wonder who has made his wife realize she wants to spend her days clipping poodle toenails and de-lousing golden retrievers. Maybe the dark-haired man in a short-sleeved Oxford, or the breasty baldy in the front row. But then Jack sees something that wipes the man, his wife, and any thought of poodle's nails out of his mind completely. Sitting two rows behind the rest of the group, where until now she has been obscured from Jack's line of sight by the second-tier balustrade, is Elliot's old babysitter, Rosita. He does not doubt for a moment that it is her, the fiercely pulled-back knot of black hair, the way she is sitting, straight-backed, head tilted slightly to the left, one hand opening and closing over the end of the armrest. The sight of her is familiar and at the same time jarringly foreign, like the sound of his own voice on an answering machine. What is she doing here, among these sad sack Americans and their vapid secular gurus? Jack takes a step to the side to see her more clearly. He can see her profile, her neck, her body now, and his own flesh freezes. She is pregnant, unmistakably. Her belly is a perfectly round protrusion under the white blouse, hard and tight as a basketball. Shock sounds through Jack like the vibration of a tuning fork struck in his head. Below him, the red-headed woman continues with a litany of thank yous that Jack can no longer make out. There is just the sound of her voice, oddly clear and monotonous, like that of an acolyte reciting an ancient, incomprehensible prayer. Staring at Rosita's small form below him, Jack waits for some fragment of information to reach his extremities and remind him how to press down the door handle, how to open the door, how to walk away. But for what seems like a long time, it doesn't come. 3. Climbing the steps to the porch of the Barton Country Day School behind Elliot's tunic-clad body, Caroline feels a swell of relief of having managed to shake Rock this morning. She has known Rock peripherally since grade school, and intimately since her freshman year at Quilton. Rock's father went to Harvard with Caroline's father, worked with him on Wall Street, and lived down the road from him in Concord until he got divorced. Every time Caroline sees him, he gives her a hearty, "I'm no sexist" clap on the shoulder and says Jack Dunlap is the ballsiest guy he knows. Jack Dunlap, on the other hand, rolls his eyes at the mention of Rock Coughlin Sr.
"That moron," he says, if anything.
Thanks to her older brother's pimping, Caroline was the stand-in for Rock's high school senior prom date, an evening she remembers with an acute sense of both embarrassment and injury, but which Rock likes to refer to, even now, as the first night of the rest of my life. He is only half sarcastic. Caroline reminds him that they didn't even kiss, and more importantly, that weeks later, when they did, it wasn't anything to write home about. Encounters with Rock, sloppy kisses at John Hoop's party, an uncomfortably sandy makeout session on the beach 4 Fourth of Julys ago, a drunken and aborted attempt at intercourse last summer, have been mixed, like so many drops of iodine into the murky waters of Caroline's teenage life. But Caroline is 22 now, and out of college. Of Harvard? When asked where, she answers as if the question mark belongs, as if, maybe, it might be unfamiliar. And now the question mark seems intrinsic to the place itself, as if, maybe, if her father hadn't gone, and his father hadn't gone, and his father's father before that, she wouldn't have gotten in. She may have reneged on the internship at the film archive in Berkeley she had lined up, but she is still a full-fledged participant, however humble, in the real world now. And while Rock, who graduated 3 years ago, seems to have been left untouched by adulthood's demand for renunciation, Caroline has embraced it whole hog. No more drunken nights on Sissy Mender's roof, or meaningless conversations with the whole Alex Perry posse. And no more rock-ups, as she refers, internally, to her hookups with Rock. Through the glass-paneled walls of the lobby, Caroline can see a host of nonsensically intense mothers, hassled teachers, and children revved up like a room full of wind-up toys. It is always mothers at these school functions. Mothers at school plays and science fairs and bake sales and open houses. And then suddenly, Caroline realized last week, it becomes all fathers at graduation. Fathers securing seats and whistling their college fight songs, carrying lamps and futons and giant Tupperware boxes full of their daughters' papers and shoes and tampons, taking pictures and being introduced, and inspecting classrooms and ancient team photos in dining halls. Proud fathers and no mothers, or invisible mothers, quiet, signed-off mothers wringing their hands and looking helpless now that the hard work is done. But here at BCD Elementary and Middle School, it is still mothers, and already Caroline recognizes a few of them, although her own is nowhere to be seen. At the front door of the school, Mrs. Corliss, Caroline's old sixth-grade teacher, is handing out programs and barking orders at a group of eighth-grade helpers waiting for their charges. To the right of the porch, Caroline can see Denise Meerhofer, Rock Coughlin Sr.'s fiancée and BCD board member. Actually, she can hear her before she can see her.
"What you don't understand," Denise is saying in the shrilly, emphatic voice she reserves for sharing her insights on anything from politics to garbage collection, "is that 6 years ago, everyone complained about this."
Caroline is about to duck around to the side entrance in the interest of avoiding her when she catches sight of an unusually tall, lanky man with shoulder-length black hair loosely pulled back into a ponytail, standing beside Denise. He looks wholly out of place among the gaggle of middle-aged women in pressed slacks and pleated shorts. He appears actually to be uninvolved in their conversation, fiddling with the viewfinder on a fancy video camera. He has olive skin and a distinctly hawkish nose and is, actually, both startlingly handsome and oddly familiar-looking. With a flick of his wrist, he snaps something shut on the camera and looks up, directly at her. Caroline feels the blood rush to her face. He has caught her staring at him. It only heightens her sense that she has seen him before. "This way," she says to Eliot more sharply than she intends to. Eliot looks back at her questioningly, but then shifts direction agreeably. Caroline feels a swell of appreciation for him. He is such an understanding little boy, has never been given to asking obnoxious questions or making scenes. The whole ride over here, he sat beside her, mouthing his lines, with his small hands crossed like an old man's on the front pocket of his backpack. He looked so serious and sincere, it sent an almost panicky pang of love through her. Inside the lobby, there is no sign yet of their mother. Eliot begins to slink off toward the back stairway.
"Elle!" Caroline says.
Her voice comes out sounding shrill.
"I think we should find Mom first."
The bright blue painted walls are giving Caroline a headache, and the whole place has the sickly smell of Windex, pencil shavings, sweaty children. Eliot stops and looks back at her impassively.
"I mean, she'll be fine," she adds. "I just think you should see her first."
Eliot frowns.
"Fine with what?" he asks.
"Oh, whatever. Just being back here, all the people, you know." Caroline lets her voice trail off. She shouldn't have said it. There is maybe no reason to think he expects otherwise. Except, of course, for the fact that he has seen his mother throw herself into the swimming pool in evening clothes and thrash around with great rips and tears of silk and nylon, that he has heard her converse freely and seriously, even respectfully, with her pillow, that he has come in to kiss her goodnight every night for a whole month in which she lay in bed, shades drawn and ocean sounds crooning at low volume from the tape player.
"She'll be so proud of you," Caroline says, hoping her voice doesn't sound insincere.
And then there is her mother, emerging from the theater, swiveling her head, clutching her shiny white purse with both hands. Caroline waves at her and flashes a mincing smile at Eliot.
"Oh, there. I was wondering. I thought maybe I..."
her mother is already saying as she approaches, anxious tapping shoes and too much perfume.
"Oh, Caroline, I'm so glad you're not off driving across country."
She stops almost hesitantly before them.
"Hi,"
Caroline says clumsily, giving her a hug. Her mother's ribs and shoulders feel tense and fragile in her arms.
"And Eliot,"
Faith says, extricating herself from Caroline's grasp.
"You look just... what a great costume."
He is not helping her out, standing absolutely still, the same flat look in his eyes. Faith extends her arm hesitantly, settling for a hand on his shoulder, as if he is some rare and delicate bird, or a prom queen, as if she is unsure a real hug is allowed.
"Oh, you look wonderful."
Of course, there are already tears springing to her eyes.
"Was your trip up okay?" Caroline asks.
In her mother's presence, she always feels dull and responsible, like an endlessly competent cruise director. She wishes she had sunglasses, nice big ones, like the ones her mother, yes, like this woman beside her, used to wear. Square, rose-tinted, maximally concealing.
"Oh, fine, fine. I got here early. I helped set up.
Faith says. You did? Caroline asks. Eliot looks alarmed. Just the chairs and nothing, really. Faith's eyes dart around the room nervously. So are you ready, Eliot? She asks, changing the topic. Your drama teacher, what a nice lady. Caroline glances at Eliot, who has pressed his lips together, turning the skin around his mouth a ghastly bluish white. It is possible he is about to faint. You probably have to go get ready, right, El? Caroline asks. Eliot nods. Good luck, she says, taking his hand and giving it a squeeze. You'll be great. Good luck, Faith echoes as he walks carefully but speedily to the back stairs. For a moment, Faith and Caroline are frozen in the middle of the lobby's wholesome chaos. Running children, fluttering construction paper cutouts, the buzz of parental instructions. Watching Elliot's blue tunic disappear. He is so small and quiet and focused. The crowd seems to part around him, like floating debris around the prow of a sailboat. Well, Caroline says. Well, Faith shifts her purse to one hand and slaps the other one against her side, as if she is about to propose something. But then what could she have to propose? She doesn't even have the confidence to hug her own son. Caroline feels a dart of anger snap up from her gut. Not only has Faith Dunlap bowed out of Caroline's own life as a mother, but she has left her little son to live with his father in a cold, unfriendly house with no more to offer than endless time to build creepy papier-mâché projects. Of course, technically, this is not her fault. The various doctors.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.